Recorded Books and RB Digital present What is Time to a Pig? By John Straley. Narrated by T. Ryder Smith. A quote from Stephen W. Hawking. Disorder increases with time because we measure time in the direction in which disorder increases. Prologue. It was late fall on the road to the dump just outside of Cold Storage, Alaska, when the mouse that would save the world scampered across the snow and first smelled a hint of rotten food. What puzzled her most was that the smell emanated not from the landfill, but from beneath her four pink and taloned feet. It was the first snowfall of the year, and just a few inches covered the ground. The smell came up from a vent in the snow, up from the damp mineral soil. Her whiskers flicked the surface, and her pink nose pushed away the crust of ice. Then she began to dig, following the air that carried the smell of something sour and edible. Down she went, through the veins of frozen roots and heart-sized stones. She followed the scent as it became stronger, her shrunken stomach rumbling. In a few feet, she came to a hard iron wall that resisted her digging, and she crawled along its edge until she encountered a long crack where the wall had buried itself into the rocks of a roadbed. There, near the edge, was a tiny gap where something had pulled against the hard wall and bent it back just enough for a thin mouse to squeeze through. After her skull was through, her stomach was nothing, and her pelvis, the other large bone in the mouse's body, could wiggle through. Once in, she smelled a world of decay and fecundity. Her stomach cinched down. She could make a nest here as long as there were no dangers. She'd seen no evidence of big animals having come this way, but still she would be careful, blend in, not rush toward the food, for that could be foolish. She would be invisible for as long as she could stand it. The mouse that would save the world was not rash nor ignorant. She worked her way around the enclosure. She heard nothing. She smelled no breath of mammal, no breath of meat eater, no footfall of hunter. She stood still for a long series of heartbeats, then moved again, then stood still again. She climbed up boxes and found rotten meat. She ate a bit and nothing moved. No traps snapped. She ate again. She found something incredibly sweet but covered in green mold. She ate a bite but then decided to save it. There were good materials to make nests. She began to relax. She peed on the box with the food to mark it as hers. She climbed another crate. She froze. Barely breathing, she stared. In the corner, behind a tangle of wires, was an animal with one eye, something that breathed in a way she had never heard before. As she stood stock still, the mouse that would save the world could not take a breath. The monster lay purring as it slowly, slowly opened and closed its one eye. Chapter 1. It might be easier to understand this story from the point of view of the mouse, for her motivations are simple. Fear, hunger, procreation, and survival. Living in the now, as a Buddhist might understand it. But for us, the Western Homo sapiens who have grown past the mysteries of peekaboo magic tricks and object impermanence, the flow of time becomes a complicating factor. Besides, the mouse died few days from when we left her, tragically for her, but not for the human beings in this story, most of whom experienced life as a kind of hallucination, unstuck from traditional time as a result of being kept in cages, where nothing happened according to their own will. It was 7 years after the U.S. president's war with North Korea, and the whole world had gone a little crazy. It was as if all the bottled-up frustration of the administration, the repressed class hatred and racism, the fear of the other, and the unquenched greed had started to spray from sprinkler systems in every office, every classroom, every store, and every network in the country. Icy water raining down through high-pressure rubber tubes onto everything and everyone. All bets were off, and the future was chaos. At least, that's how it seemed. The fizzled North Korean missile was nothing more than a bundle of sparklers that sprinkled warheads over a small section of southeastern Alaska. The warheads had apparently been meant for Valdez, Prudhoe Bay, and down into Wyoming and Colorado. The North Koreans had thought to contaminate most of America's oil supplies to frighten U.S. leaders to the negotiating table. But what really happened was a mad rush by military and terrorist groups from around the globe to gather the missing nukes while the rest of the world watched the U.S. Army and subcontractors liberate the hungry North Koreans. First came fire and destruction, then a river of American food, MREs, and then fatty, grain-fed beef, along with televisions playing dubbed American films over steam tables laden with limp, yellowy pork chops, grease-limp cheeseburgers, and boiled cabbage with brisket, all under the watchful eye of white men with black guns and sunglasses. But none of that mattered to the men serving time out on the island where the Ted Stevens High-Security Federal Penitentiary had been built. Olympus, as it was known to its full-time inhabitants, or TSHSFP on their paperwork. The employees, who rotated on and off-site, called it tough shit. Whatever you decided to call it, it was a concrete facility built on a rocky outcropping off the coast of Jacoby Island. The nearest civilian town was Cold Storage, Alaska. Now it was 1730, October 31st, 2027, almost 5 years after the final peace accord with China, North Korea, and the end of hostilities. The world was still in a frenzy of nervous breastbeating and anxiety about dodging the bullet of nuclear annihilation. The United States had somehow balanced its trade deficit with Asia. There was no more Republican Party, but a new Democratic Business Party and the Constitutionalist Party of the American nation. The evening meal had been served in the red and blue units, and the white unit was just finishing up its sobriety, substance, and spirituality class in the cool-down space, which had thick windows overlooking the North Pacific and was plumbed with pipes to flood the room with either salt water from the surrounding ocean or imported military gas. Gloomy Knob was the speaker on this day. Gloomy, of course, wasn't his real name, but the name given to him as a boy by the community. Gloomy Knob had grown up in Cold Storage and had graduated from the local high school. He had earned enough money working in the woods, cutting trees, and working on machinery in Alaska, Washington, and Idaho. He had been living at home and building a cabin when he was arrested. He had been building a new life, or so he thought. He was one of only two inmates who were locals. He and Ishmael Muhammad were the only two prisoners from Cold Storage held on Olympus. Gloomy had been given his nickname, and really the only name he used, for a cliff face in Glacier Bay he had liked to visit as a boy. Gloomy Knob was a bluff where to this day mountain goats love to climb up and down from tidewater all the way to the alpine willows. It was a place where Tlingit elders went to gather goat hair that had sloughed onto the willow branches. Gloomy's father, Clive, had taken him there, and his mother had shown him how the old people would make yarn and small panels of rough cloth that they eventually stitched together into a blanket. Clive had run a bar that also served as a small non-denominational and eclectic church in the tiny village of Cold Storage, which was how Gloomy Knob had become the unofficial non-denominational pastor of the clearly non-Christian and non-Islamic sobriety, substance, and spirituality discussion group at Ted Stevens High Security Federal Penitentiary, even though he abhorred most public speaking. Yes, Gloomy had become a preacher in jail. "Gentlemen," Gloomy began, "I will start today, as I often do, with a story." The men groaned. They sat on shiny, steep pillars that had emerged from the floor and were immovable. Tables and a lectern could also rise through the steel-plated concrete floor by hydraulic force when needed, but nothing could be moved or thrown. 28 men in lime-green jumpsuits sat on pillars. Some wore tight-fitting skullcaps, some had shaved heads. Some had vivid tattoos, while some conspicuously did not. So, Gloomy continued despite protests, a farmer was in his orchard with his pig as a city slicker was driving by in his sports car, clearly in a hurry. I got this already. The pig is a filthy beast. It represents the fallen sinner. The farmer is your false prophet, Jesus, a man with a beard called out as others nodded. Gentlemen, please. Gloomy raised his hands, palms up. In some stories, a man is just a farmer, and a pig is just a pig. Please. And the grunting subsided. So, as the city slicker is driving by, the farmer lifts up the pig to the apple tree and lets the pig feed on an apple. The pig chews away on the nice big apple, and the farmer sets him back down. Then, as the car gets closer, the farmer does it again, and the city slicker sees that this is a big fat pig, and the farmer is straining a lot to lift the animal up. The city slicker slams on the brakes and grinds to a stop, then jumps out of the sports car and walks over to the farmer. What did he say? A black inmate said unselfconsciously. I will tell you, sir. And Gloomy walks toward the inmates, a row of cameras in the ceiling following his every move. The city slicker says, I was watching you, mister, and I think it would be much easier if you tried something else, Mr. Farmer. I'm sure he did. Now the black inmates were laughing. Thank you for the encouragement, said Gloomy Knob, pausing to look each and every one of them gathered there in that antiseptic holding facility in the eye. Then the farmer lifts that pig up again, straining every muscle. The pig eats another sweet and delicious apple, then the farmer sets the pig back down. The city slicker says, I think if you were to climb up in the tree and shake all the limbs and knock the apples down on the ground, the pig could just eat the apples off the ground. It'd be a lot easier for you and the pig, and it would save a lot of time. What do you say, Gloomy? What'd the farmer say? And Gloomy Knob held up both his hands again and said, That farmer walked over to that city slicker as his fine sports car was idling like a purring cat by the side of the road and said, Well, yes, sir, I suppose you are right. But what is time to a pig? And here the gathering resorted to a respectful and knowing laugh, and they rocked back and forth on their uncomfortable perches. After Gloomy's father's generation, everyone in cold storage went by nicknames. Gloomy Knob took his name into prison. Gloomy Knob was convicted of murdering his sister and kidnapping his mother. His sister was called No-No. His mother was called Nix. His cousin had taken the name Ishmael Muhammad, but he was known as Itchy to his family. They had both been convicted for involvement in the kidnapping of Gloomy's mother, who had long ago been a bass player in a cruise ship band and had married into the bar, but neither of them felt guilty for the kidnapping. Someone else had taken Nix and buried her in a box in a tide flat with a breathing tube to motivate both the boys. They never counted that as a charge against them, even though the government had added it onto their sentence. Gloomy didn't talk about the past much due to his grief and guilt over No-No's death, and Ishmael never spoke up, apparently for ideological reasons. At the time, Ishmael had deep religious beliefs to explain his actions. In prison, each prisoner had to discover his own particular way of doing time. In the last few months, Gloomy hadn't seen his cousin in the prison, and his memory had become a stuttering and chaotic dream that interrupted his waking life. Gloomy could look at a clock and then look again and have lost hours while visiting some other time in his life, which gave him great anxiety as to how time was actually passing. Hence the pig joke. What interested him most was why many of the other inmates found the odd joke funny. Nix kept replaying the events in her mind. She didn't see the men who took her. She had been walking down the gravel lane, and it was suddenly dark. She twisted inside a scratchy bag for several moments, and then everything was gone. There was no struggle, no scratchiness, and no sounds of boots running down the gravel lane. Sometime later, she awoke in darkness so pure that she couldn't be certain her eyes were even open. Her arms were pinned to her side, and as she twisted her torso, she could feel the rough surface of the wooden box she had been buried in. She kicked her feet and heard dirt shifting down around her head. Her breath came back against her face as she struggled. The smell of peanut butter from her sandwich at lunch mingled with the yeasty scent of the wet rocky sand that had been heaped on top of her. She banged her head against the surface of the box, and her forehead butted against the end of a pipe. Cool air came down the pipe, and she could hear the swooshing sound of waves breaking on a beach. Somewhere in the dark was the barking call of a raven. A drop of water dripped down the pipe and landed on her lips. "O Father who art in heaven," she began. Then a voice interrupted her. She didn't recognize the voice. It was a distant hiss that seemed to be riding down the air through the pipe.
"Hush,"
the voice said.
"Help me. Please help me out of here," Nick said. "Hush,"
the voice wheezed again.
"I will.
Why am I in here? When will you let me out? I'm sorry. I'm sorry."
She felt her tears track down her cheek and get cradled in the folds of her ears.
"Don't ask questions,"
the voice said soothingly.
"There is only one answer worth knowing."
"What?"
she said, stammering. Her heart was beating inside her chest as if it were kicking to get out.
"What is it? Please, what is it?"
"Close your eyes."
The voice came all around her body. She could still hear waves breaking. She kicked against the box, shaking dirt down the sides.
"In a few moments, you will know the answer,"
the voice said. The darkness sat on her, and the smell of the earth filled her nose and mouth. A fat drop of water landed on her open eye. As Gloomy and the other prisoners filed back to their cells to read their religious materials, a technician spun on his chair in a bunker buried three levels down beneath the housing floor of the prison. This was a secure area with just two entrances, its own communications trunk, and a dedicated dock and helipad on the far side of the facility. This security team had one office at the prison and one temporary communication center and interview room in the town of Cold Storage. The technician handed his boss a file.
"It took the Iranians fucking years to give the specs to the Koreans, and then it took their people forever to work through their lawyers before we could get it to our technicians and sort out all the noise and what looked like chatter and background stuff.
Enough with the caveats, Pete. Just tell me."
"There is a faint but intermittent transmission of a power source being fed to one detonator."
"Where is it?"
"Here. Alaska."
"Alaska? Really?"
"They didn't have satellites, they didn't have GPS, they didn't expect they would be hard to find."
"How far along are we to detonation?"
"Unknown."
"Unknown? A thermonuclear device? Unknown?"
"Jasper,"
the technician cupped his head in his hands and took a long breath.
"You want me to quit and go home?"
"I want you to wander around in the fucking woods until you find it or it goes off. That is what I want."
Jasper, the supervisor, wore a short-sleeved shirt with brown stains down the front. After he read the memo one last time, he clipped the document to his board and drank a long swallow, one of many, of cold, bitter coffee. Both Jasper and Pete were discovering a new and irritable way of experiencing time. A way that felt like a jittering caffeine nightmare, as if they were both drowning in the surf and trying to drag themselves back to shore without touching bottom. Now, while Gloomy was telling the joke about the pig and the farmer in prison, and Jasper was feeling his stomach ache about the bomb, Nix was in cold storage, Alaska, wiping the cedar bar top with a dry towel. She had set her sketch pad down a moment before, and one of her drawings had been smeared with beer. She came to the bar sometimes when she couldn't stand the atmosphere of the house where her husband lay dying. Lily, the nurse who usually slept above the old cold storage, had agreed to stay the night. She had been making bread and was reading a book from Clive's library. In the last few weeks, when it seemed that he was going to die at any moment, Lily had virtually moved in. Lily was strong and patient with him. Patience was what Nix had wished for. Patience while lifting him onto the commode or changing his diaper in the middle of the night.
"If we're lucky,"
Lily had said to Nix just that night.
"If we're lucky, this is how we end up, I suppose."
She paused.
"At home with people who care about you."
Nix had been putting on her slicker to go out to the bar as Lily stood in the kitchen kneading bread dough.
"Yes,"
Nix said. Lily was looking down at the floor.
"I don't mind it,"
Lily said softly.
"He's got a long trip ahead. I don't mind helping him get ready now."
Lily was a blessing to Nix. She gave her time to get out of the house, time to sit and work on her drawings. Blessed time away from the dying in the upstairs bedroom. Nix hated it. She hated the smell of the house, the disinfectant in the bucket for dirty linens, the sour smell that made even the warm kitchen with baking bread smell boggy. Norma, the barmaid on duty, brought Nix a martini. Nix held her mechanical pencil above the paper. Every time she was about to begin a new drawing, she would remember the words her art teacher had made her write in ink all around the top of her computer monitor at school. She had looked at those words every day, whether she consciously read them or not. When beginning any depiction, the artist must consider the angle and the source of the light. She held her pencil steady and took a drink. She didn't really like martinis, but she wanted something that would change her mood. Yet, when she sipped the cocktail, all she tasted was the disinfectant in Clive's room. She set the long-stemmed glass down gently and took a deep breath. This moment of beginning a new drawing always created tension within Nix. It was a delicious tension, like the moment just before kissing a stranger. She placed the tip of her pencil down and drew the first curve of a raven's beak. Like with the kiss, she could tell how propitious the next move and the one after that would be. There was the curve of the head in profile. There was the raucous call and the weird intelligence. There was the source of light slanting in at a long angle from the southeast where Raven stood on the ridge of a roof, tipping forward and ready to fall into the gliding first curve of flight. This first feeling having been revealed to her, Nix hurried on to capture the moment. She sketched from the top down. She even put in a faint background. The world itself became visible as the new light fell upon the bird. Norma walked down her side of the bar, turning and twisting her back to loosen her tight muscles.
"You want to trade for your tab?"
Norma joked.
"Can't afford to."
Nix smiled as her forearm moved across the page.
"I might if I drank more, but I've got to zap these down to the editors and the book designers in 3 weeks or I don't get the second half of the advance."
Norma craned her head and watched Nix draw. Raven on a roofline, the islands in the background, Raven leaning forward as if he were going to spill out the rest of the drawing. Norma was some 20 years younger than Nix. She was thin, weathered, with short brown hair and a bright scar on the left side of her throat. Nix never asked about the scar, not because she wasn't curious, but because she already knew part of the story and didn't care to know any more. She knew because she had shared in the events that had left the mark on her old friend's throat.
"How's it going at home?"
Norma said, and her voice softened, hesitant to ask.
"It's going," Nix said absently, then stopped and looked up at the barmaid. "It's going slowly," Nix said finally, staring into her friend's eyes. "I had to get out of there."
Norma reached over and covered Nix's hand with her own, and she let it sit there a moment without saying a word.
"Well, tonight will be some distraction," Norma's voice brightened. "Halloween! My God, there will be some loonies in here for sure."
Nix swiveled around in her chair, looking out the windows of the bar as if to remind herself what time it was and what month.
"Halloween," she said. "I must have forgotten."
It was early evening and already very dark. The wires above the boardwalk along the beach swung crazily in the gusts of wind. Rain sheeted down the smudged window panes, the windows fogged where they reached the level of the booths. Outside, one light flickered as if it couldn't decide whether it was going to burn out. The rain fell through the light as if it were a ripped curtain flapping there. Two electric carts hummed by, and a rusted-out gas cart sputtered down the boardwalk like a rock slide. Dance music wheezed out of a radio and then faded into the clatter of the bar. A guy by the pool table was bobbing his head in time to the sound effects of the game he was playing on his goggles. His vision obscured, he slowly pulled his beer glass toward his mouth by instinct and feel alone. Nix thought of the man dying in her house. He had been a jailbird and a drug dealer long ago. But he and his brother were good men and had built a community in cold storage that she had grown to love. She loved him. She loved his crazy preaching on Sundays. She had sat with him for days during his sickness. She had cried, and now she was ready for him to die. She looked down and pictured his shrunken body as his bony chest rose and fell.
"I'm not worried," Clive said, as if he could read her thoughts.
Then he said in his reed-thin voice,
"Not near as worried as you are, girl."
Nix tried to smile.
"That's good," she stammered. "I don't think there's anything to worry about."
But as she said the words, she felt icy gravel gather in her chest.
"There's nothing to worry about," she said again, this time with a little more force. Clive had been so much fun, so irreverent and funny, but now he was pale and his eyes were still. He blinked once in slow, reptilian consideration. She felt her hand shake, and he gripped them firmly as if to apologize for the awkwardness of dying.
"Here we go," Norma said and took a deep breath. At the door, some kids were running back and forth, daring each other to knock. They were all wearing sheets over their heads.
"Come on,"
Norma said. She elbowed Nix as she reached under the bar for two big handfuls of wrapped toffee.
"Let's give the ghouls something," she said as she moved around the end of the bar.
A couple of fishermen, in wool coats with the sleeves cut off, pushed their dirty linen caps back off their faces and sat up straight in the booth by the window. They made faces at the specters running back and forth on the sidewalk. They looked through the records that the bar kept near the old stereo system, and one looked at Nix to make sure he had her approval. Nix smiled at him because she recognized him and liked his taste. The fisherman put on Louis Armstrong and Ella Fitzgerald. Knowing there was a scratch on side one, he put on the second side and sat down with his partner, who spilled his beer. The other started swearing as he squeezed back into the booth, never taking either of his hands off his beer. Nix threw them a bar rag because Norma's hands were full of candy. Both women arrived at the door at the same time, and just as the smallest of the four ghosts was about to knock, Norma jerked the door open.
"Boo!"
she shouted, and she sent the ghosts shrieking and jumping back. They laughed and then eased forward, holding out plastic bags with their dark mouths open.
"Trick or treat,"
the four of them sang out in unison. Nix stood behind Norma's right shoulder. She looked at the children and for some reason felt short of breath. It was a familiar feeling, that of struggling for air. She did not move, but stared at the tiny ghosts with half-dollar-sized holes in the white sheets. Their eyes were far back from their ill-defined skulls. The smallest wore a plastic garland of flowers that had been used in last year's fifth-grade play. As Norma was doling out the candy, a rumble came from the south as a plastic garbage can rolled in the middle of the boardwalk, for there were no roads in this little boardwalk town in the Alaskan wilderness. The wires running to the back of the hotel started howling, and a great gust of wind hit the side of the building. The kids shrieked, and the wind pushed the door wide open against the wall. The napkins on the bar scattered like leaves, and the kids howled all the louder, wind billowing up underneath their costumes and lifting the sheets up off their heads faster than they could grab them while still holding on to their bags of candy. Norma stepped back, turning away from the blast of wind, but Nix watched with a kind of fixed panic as the ghosts' costumes rose up into the air, twisting and spinning like single sheets of newspaper blown down the canyon of the street. They rose straight up above the roofline toward the waterfront until all four sheets became entangled in the power lines running down to the harbor. The rain came suddenly, pelting down out of the blackness of the squall. The little girl ghosts ran into the bar, shivering and laughing, holding onto their candy bags with both hands. Norma got a dry towel, and the fisherman ordered another round of beers. The embarrassed little girls covered their mouths as they spoke and sucked down their giggles as they asked if they could call their mothers. Nix walked over to the windows and watched the wind push the twisted sheets against the power lines. When the wet tip of one of the sheets slapped against another, sparks showered down on the street and the bar went black.
"There's no saving them now," Nix said aloud, although she hadn't meant to.
The girls who had once been ghosts laughed and shivered in their thin, wet clothes as Ella Fitzgerald's voice skittered up into the darkness. Chapter 2. Like all inmates on Olympus, Gloomy Knob had tags around his neck. On these metal tags were stamped his real name and his identification number. These tags could either be swiped through a reader or placed into a machine, and given the proper access codes, the corresponding inmate's entire file would be pulled up, including his medical, legal, military, NSA, OGA, and CIA files, and even nuclear regulatory and security information. Almost any bonehead at the prison could read that Gloomy's real name was Christopher McKeon. What they might not have known was his father was Clive McKeon, and that Gloomy had grown up in a bar in Cold Storage, Alaska, called Mouse Miller's Love Nest, the very same bar Nix was sitting in at this moment. Clive ran the bar as a genuine community center, and on Sundays it was a spiritual meeting place. Clive once told his brother, Miles, who had been a medical practitioner for the village, that he loved Jesus like Elvis loved his mama. Clive loved Jesus the way he loved Duke Ellington or the great Satchmo or the early music of Joni Mitchell or Bonnie Raitt. He loved Jesus the way he loved the opening paragraph of 100 Years of Solitude or all the novels of P.G. Wodehouse. This is not to say that Clive McKeon was a pious man. Remember, his house of worship served mixed drinks. But Clive McKeon was a man who had been moved by the Spirit. Gloomy Knob grew up both in the bar and in his grandma's house, where his father and mother lived. His mother had been a bass player in the first house band at the Love Nest. The band had been called Blind Donkey. His mother was named Maya, but everyone called her Nix. Gloomy had a sister who had been baptized in the bar as Nancy Vishnu McKeon, but everyone called her No-No. Gloomy was serving a life sentence for the death of No-No. Gloomy had never given a statement as to the circumstances surrounding her death and had insisted upon pleading guilty to the crime. He refused to testify against his co-defendant in his implicated crimes. Gloomy Knob, his sister, and Ishmael grew up together in Cold Storage, Alaska. There are no roads either in or around Cold Storage. The only road is a short lane up to the dump used by the city truck, which serves as a police van and also pulls the garbage trailer up. The only ways into the village are by boat or float plane. The nearest large towns are Juneau to the east and Sitka to the south. Pelican, Alaska, lies up the coast a bit, and Gustavus is across Icy Strait toward Glacier Bay. Cold Storage has a hot springs, a small ice plant, and a fish-buying station for the small boat fleet. It also now houses a few prison employees along the coast, though not many, since most of the employees choose to take their 2 weeks a month off in a more lively setting. All told, Cold Storage has about 200 year-round residents, and in the summer, there are a few more charter fishermen and operators, along with some lodge operators. Gloomy's great-aunt was an anarchist named Ellie Hobbs. She was the one who built the bar in the first place after she came to Cold Storage in the 30s with a man who would be her husband, Slippery Wilson. He had been a rancher, but they were on the lam when they arrived in Alaska. Gloomy never knew her, and he never knew his grandmother, Annabelle, who had also made the trip up in the dory with Ellie and Slippery, but he heard the stories told endlessly in the bar at night. His father would toast to them at closing time. Somehow, there was a strong link with both anarchism and Christianity in Clive McKeon's faith, which had begun to irritate Gloomy in his early teenage years. When Gloomy started hanging out in Glacier Bay and sitting up on the actual Gloomy Knob in the national park, he would take only the scriptures and read them under a tarp. And there he would pray out toward the water and try to imagine the arid holy lands as the rain sluiced down the sheer face of the black rocks where the mountain goats gamboled and would sometimes stop, stock still, and stare at him. Nicknames for their generation had become almost required. There had become a naming ceremony that took place on 13th birthdays, like a bar or bat mitzvah, which happened at the Love Nest. The young initiate had to give a spiritual reading, and their mentor also gave a talk as to their spiritual progress. Gloomy gave a reading from Moby Dick, and as a poke in the eye to his father, he asked the pastor from the other church in town to talk about Gloomy's faith in Jesus. Nick's played a favorite family song called Love is the Answer, But What is the Question? And Clive played an old vinyl recording of the Barrett sisters singing I Don't Feel No Ways Tired, followed by scratchy gospel records all night long. Gloomy didn't like that his father had been a drug dealer. He didn't like that he sold alcohol 6 days a week and only quoted scripture about God's love and never about our duty to be obedient, our absolute duty, what Gloomy saw as the first commandment. No truth, no justice. Wasn't that what all the people chanted out in front of the buildings? He had seen them on the news. He could not imagine his father crusading for anything. He was a good times Christian. He was only in it for the love, the art, and the beauty. But none of that mattered now. Gloomy was being put through his own trial. He had killed his own sister. There were no more good times to be had. There was only his prison job, tending a bonfire at the construction site for the new women's prison. That was the best life he could hope for, or want. Gloomy loved this job. It got him outside. It made him feel at home. Others didn't want it, thinking it cold and awful, but he could think of nothing he wanted more than to stand on the beach and burn construction trash with a guard holding a gun on him. A short piece of pipe insulation floated out into the inlet. It was curled like a piece of macaroni, moving toward a rock in the middle of the channel. The moon was pulling all the water of the world to one side of the planet and pulling this bit of pipe insulation along with it. The rock looked like an elephant garlanded in slippery kelp banners. An eagle launched from an overhanging spruce and swept down for a look. Gloomy blew his warm breath on his hands and watched the whole scene. The eagle flew close to the pipe insulation and lowered its talons toward the gray-green water, but at the last moment pulled up and flew around the point of the island and out of sight. A fat guard came out of the construction shack carrying a propane torch. He had been at this worksite a long time with Gloomy, and over time he had let the convict refer to him by his first name, Tommy. As long as no other prison personnel were around, Tommy didn't mind. It seemed to make the time go faster. Tommy lumbered clumsily over the slick rocks and, in his full uniform and heavy utility belt, bent over the fire pit and flicked the lighter in front of the torch. The blue flame jumped toward a corner of a cardboard box filled with 2x4 scraps. Smoke rose and curled out into the gray sky. Ravens hopped near the fire pit, where Tommy always threw the remains of his pastries from the day before. The ravens had come to expect it and arrived as soon as the shore boat pulled up to the construction float, which was 10 yards from the fire pit. Tommy threw a vanilla almond croissant to a big black bird and then jacked a shell into the chamber of his rifle. He set the safety and slung the gun with the laser sight around his shoulder using the clip sling, which would let him pull the gun into a firing position with one motion. Tommy kicked more boxes over to Gloomy and motioned with his chin that it was all right for Gloomy to pick up his fire tool. The tool was a pitchfork with 4 blunted tines and a bright red 4-foot handle. Gloomy pitched a roll of electrical wire into the fire, and black smoke sizzled out of the flames. Tommy nodded at the wire.
Jeez, may still getting rid of that order?
Gloomy nodded and said nothing, just as he was supposed to. He had been burning a roll of this wire every day for more than a month. Apparently, the wrong shipment had come in, and because of problems in purchasing, it was better to burn the first order. Gloomy poked the roll of expensive wire into the flames and watched the insulation burn black, exposing the glass and silver core.
Did you hear about the penguin who rented a car in Arizona?
Tommy asked, and Gloomy shook his head. Tommy went on, but Gloomy didn't listen, just as he hadn't listened for the last 654 days that Tommy had been working. Rain began to fall, and Gloomy pushed dry wood from some broken pallets around the burning spool of fiber optic wire. The raven had lumbered away with the croissant. 3 small crows were harassing the larger bird. 2 other ravens pulled a cruller apart and then hopped in and out of the smoke while they tried to fly away with their booty. Sparks rose up in the smoke and blinked out.
I mean, it's a real penguin from the North Pole or wherever, not a nun.
Tommy kept telling the joke, and Gloomy nodded as if listening while he stood on his tiptoes watching the pipe insulation disappear. The tide kept running. The rock was up on its haunches now because the tide was going out, garlands sagging down to the sand sculpted around its base. A helicopter circled like an injured bug far above the fire. Gloomy's side hurt. This was only his 3rd day back on the job, following an attack. He had had to fill out a wellness form, lie to the doctor, and write something in his official journal, which he hated to do, but not as much as he hated being on Ward 11 with the meat pumps. The clinics were full, and Gloomy would rather be out in the rain with his broken ribs and infection anyway, because he so loved being a fire tender. The attack had been over before he was aware of being hurt. He was in a crowd outside the pharmacy. He didn't need any meds, but as he pushed his way around an inmate, he felt pain run up his side, sharp, then dull. Gloomy remembered men walking quickly away, the sound of their footsteps receding as he stared up at himself in the smoky glass ceiling. Soon there was an alarm and the sound of closing doors. Blood spread across his white shirt and down his tan pants slowly, like a time-lapse image of a flower blooming on TV. Gloomy didn't know who had shanked him, and he wasn't that concerned as long as it meant he could have a single unit. He was back in population, which was not the usual drill, but Gloomy didn't file a grievance because being in protective segregation was worse than being in the hole. Protective seg was 24-hour lockdown, with 3 hours a day in a private yard so you could throw a ball at a bare hoop. You never saw the other convicts, but you could hear them. Protective SEG was full of rapists and snitches. They were the worst kinds of talkers. These were men who gained advantage by insinuating themselves into whatever non-violent nature you had left. They attached themselves to you like sea anemones to a tarred piling. Once they had you in a conversation through the bars, there was never a moment's peace. You would hear their dreams, anxieties, and fantasies. They were always niggling for a confession from you, always looking for a bond. Gloomy had once spent a stretch in protective SEG with a towel wrapped tightly around his ears. He was glad to be back in population now, even if it meant he might be killed. Gloomy turned a burning 2x4 over and flipped it into the flames. The guard kicked another box of scrap wood over toward the fire. They were supposed to go through all the materials to make sure there wasn't any contraband or dangerous materials. Gloomy was serving a life sentence, so he had a high security rating, SR 100. The SR rating should have made it illegal for Gloomy to have his hands on any sharp tools or materials that could be fashioned into tools. But the truth was that Gloomy was a 34-year-old lifer who would do anything the guards asked rather than risk losing this job, which got him off the main campus. The construction site was to be the new women's facility. There was a stream of federal dollars for prison construction after the Soledad and Pelican Bay riots and the corrections strike of 2021. The California riots and corrections strike had been uglier than the Arizona riots in the 70s and had changed the prison industry forever. In the summer of 2021, prisoners started killing and dismembering guards, spraying the walls red with arterial blood. After the first 4 days, they naturally turned to the snitches and trustees. After the first 7 days, all structure in the convicts' community...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.